Hello friends, hope all of you are safe and healthy and keeping up with your preparation as well. In the current affairs online video series that we smart leaders have started, let us move on to the second video on the environment current affairs for the month of June 2019. The first news to come up is about the discovery of a new frog species called as Microletta aeshani in the state of Assam. Now, the name, it's a biological name, Microletta aeshani. The word Microletta is actually referring to what are called as narrow-mouthed paddy frogs, which are most commonly found in the Southeast Asia. Microletta is a narrow-mouthed paddy frogs that are widely distributed in the Southeast Asia. The term aeshani, it's a Sanskrit word that refers to what is called as Northeast. So it's a narrow-mouthed paddy frogs that have been discovered in Assam is what the name stands for. And Microletta aeshani have been discovered in Assam, even though Western Ghats is usually referred as the hotspot for amphibians biodiversity. And later, the species was also discovered in the state of Tripura and Manipur also. To say about few unique characteristics of this species, Microletta aeshani is seasonal and are active only during the early monsoon season. And it also differs from other narrow-mouthed paddy frogs by certain unique characteristics. They are a prominent reddish-brown coloration on its back and a very distinct dark lateral lineup on the sides of the body, the absence of a snout on its mouth, which is why it is called as narrow-mouthed frog, and the absence of web also. Usually frogs are known to have webs in their feet, but Microletta aeshani will not have any web. In terms of similar narrow-mouthed paddy frogs, there are so far about four such species that have been recognized, but Microletta aeshani is known to be found only in Northeast India, which I've said earlier, Assam, Tripura and Manipur, but it is widely expected to be present in the neighboring states of Bangladesh and Myanmar also. In terms of its economic importance, because it's a newly discovered species, its economic importance has not been well understood, but already we have known about the frog species. Frog species are considered as an indicators of the healthy and unpolluted aquatic ecosystems. Moving to the next. Now this is about color morphs of wild cat. Okay, but what are color morphs? Like the picture that is given in the slide, it's a picture of a lady beetle. But it is very clear for us that lady beetle, even though they belong to the same species, they often differ in their external morphological structure such as color formation. So, whenever the skin color of the same species differs, they are called as color morphs. So, color morphs is a phenomenon of occurrence of two or more discrete color forms. That's why it is called as color morphs. So, two or more discrete color forms of the same species within a population. Another example for this phenomenon is black panther is actually a color morph of common leopard. Now, why this color morph occurs? The color morph occurrence is due to the natural evolutionary process of mutations. And once the mutation occurs, it stabilizes in the population through natural selection. Why color morphs and this topic is in the news? Because scientists from Zoological Society of London and University College of London have discovered six color morphs in one location. And this location is Dibang Valley of Arunachal Pradesh and the species is golden cat. So six color morphs of golden cat was found in a single location of Dibang Valley of Arunachal Pradesh. And by this, it was already known that Dibang Valley of Arunachal Pradesh is known to have the world's most diverse range of color morphs of the wild cat ever reported from a single site. The species of discussion is golden cat. This Asiatic golden cat is a medium-sized wild cat that are native to northeastern Indian subcontinent. And in terms of its conservation status, the golden cat is listed as a near threatened in the IUCN. And in terms of Wildlife Protection Act, it is a Schedule 1 species. And under Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Flora and Fauna, also called as CITES. Under CITES, it's an Appendix 1 species. Now coming to the significance of the study. As we have discussed earlier, that color morphs is an outcome of natural evolution. Understanding the color morphs will help us to know how quickly the species can adapt and evolve to the changing environmental conditions. Second, the color morphs actually give certain advantage to the species. So, it also gives a better insight into the resilience capacity of the species to climate change or habitat destruction or other environmental changes. And third, it is also contributing to the conservation of the Asiatic golden cats because color morphs provides ecological benefits to them. There are two ecological benefits that it provides. One, it enables them to occupy wide range of ecosystems from lowland, wet tropical lowland forest to high altitude alpine scrubs. The first ecological benefit it gives, and the second, the color morphs gives camouflage advantages to these animals when they are hunting their prey such as pheasants and rabbits. Third, the topic of UN habitat. In 1976, the first UN conference on human settlements and sustainable urban development, also called as Habitat One conference, was held in Vancouver of Canada. And as an outcome of this 1976 Habitat One conference, UN Habitat was established in the year 1978. Its headquarters is located at the UN office at Nairobi of Kenya, and it is mandated by the UN General Assembly to promote socially and environmentally sustainable towns and cities with a goal of providing adequate shelter for all. UN Habitat is a member of UN Development Group and it has twin objectives. One, adequate shelter for all. Second, development of sustainable human settlements in an urbanizing world. In terms of the governance of the UN Habitat, the two main bodies are UN Habitat Assembly and the Executive Board. UN Habitat Assembly is having the quota of 193 member states of the UN General Assembly, and it usually convenes every once in 4 years in Nairobi. Coming to Executive Board. Now this is the second decision-making body of this program. It is made up of 36 member states. So the difference between UN Habitat Assembly and the Executive Board is UN Habitat Assembly is represented by all UN member states. But in terms of Executive Board, only 36 members from UN members are elected with the representatives from every regional groups. The board meets 3 times annually. The UN Habitat Assembly, as I said earlier, was established in 1978, but even then, its assembly was not been convened since 2019. So for two reasons it was in the news. The first one, its first UN Habitat Assembly was convened in the year 2019 in Nairobi, Kenya. One. The second, India was elected to the Executive Board of the UN Habitat. And as I said earlier, Executive Board is representational from regional groups. India is a representative of Asia Pacific Regional Group that has 8 seats, which includes Sri Lanka, Republic of South Korea, China, Japan, India, Iran, Indonesia and Pakistan. The theme of the first assembly is innovation for better quality of life in cities and communities. Now, what are the outcomes of this assembly? The important outcomes includes contribution of about more than $152 million to making cities inclusive, safer, resilient, and sustainable by the member states. The second outcome, the introduction of the idea of waste-wise cities. And under this idea, any communities, cities, or towns that improve their solid waste management, waste footprint, and reducing their waste management expenditure will be recognized as waste-wise cities under Human Habitat. This idea will be relying on the principle of 5R: rethink, reduce, recycle, refuse, and reuse waste. The third outcome in this assembly, the strategic plan for the period 2020 to 2025 was also presented. And the fourth outcome, the participating members have presented their annual statements on efforts to promote the new urban agenda and sustainable urban development. As an heads up, new urban agenda was introduced in October 2016 during the UN Conference on Housing and Sustainable Urban Development, also called as Habitat 3. The next topic, 4, is about the proposal for the inclusion of Dhanauri wetland into the Ramsar sites. Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change have requested the Uttar Pradesh Forest Department to initiate steps to introduce Dhanauri in Greater Noida of Uttar Pradesh as a wetland of international importance under Ramsar Convention. To apprise a small info here, in India, the administration of wetlands falls under the jurisdiction of the state governments. That is the reason why MOEF has requested UP Forest Department to take steps. And once accepted, Dhanauri will get international recognition and efforts to protect from land use change, such as alternative uses such as agriculture or diversion to real estates. It is also important to remember here that Ramsar Convention and the Ramsar sites does not offer any legal recognition to the wetlands that have been recognized under the convention. Now, what are the reasons why the Dhanauri wetland was chosen as one of the Ramsar sites? The two reasons are, the one, Dhanauri supports a large population of saurus cranes. How much is that? About, it has more than 1% of the biogeographic population of one species is occupied by saurus crane itself. That's the first reason. And the second reason, congregation of more than 20,000 water birds, waterfowls, and other species. To add a few points here, saurus crane is the tallest flying bird in the world, with length of about 152 to 156 centimeters tall, and it has a wingspan of about 240 centimeters. It is mostly a non-migratory bird, even though it is known to make some relatively short distance migrations. It is commonly called as a non-migratory bird. In terms of its population, there are three disconnected populations found in the world. There are three disconnected populations of saurus crane found in the world. The first is found in the Indian subcontinent. The second population is found in Southeast Asia. And the third is found in the Northern Australia. And in the Indian subcontinent, it is found in Northern and Central India, Terai of Nepal, and Pakistan. In terms of the conservation status, it is a vulnerable species under IUCN. It falls under Schedule 4 Species of Wildlife Protection Act 1986, and it is Appendix 2 species under CITES. While the proposal for Dhanauri wetlands to be included in the Ramsar Sites of International Importance is underway, what are the existing wetlands that are found in the Uttar Pradesh under Ramsar list? There are 7 Ramsar wetlands found in the Uttar Pradesh as of now. The first one is Nawabganj Bird Sanctuary. Nawabganj Bird Sanctuary, it is a wetland fed by the monsoon. It is also an habitat for endangered species of Egyptian vulture and Pallas fish eagle. The second wetland is Parvati Agra Bird Sanctuary. Parvati Agra Bird Sanctuary, it is fed by Sariu River. It is home to critically endangered white rumped vulture and Indian vulture, and the endangered species of Egyptian vulture. The third one is Salmon Bird Sanctuary. It is monsoon fed. It is home to Sarus crane and gator spotted eagle. The remaining four wetlands are Samaspur Bird Sanctuary, Sandy Band Sanctuary, Bird Sanctuary, Sarsai Nawar Jheel, and Upper Ganga River, which you can find in the map given along with the presentation. The topic number five, it is about the establishment of India's first emission trading system for particulate matter. Emissions trading is an idea that was established through Kyoto Protocol of 1997. The emissions trading has been mandatory for Annex II countries, but India is a non-annex member under Kyoto Protocol. Because it is a non-annex member under the Kyoto Protocol, it is not mandatory for India to engage in emissions trading programs at all. But this, the emissions trading that was first introduced in India, is a voluntary exercise. It is not mandated under Kyoto Protocol. It is a voluntary exercise that is introduced for regulating and reducing the particulate matter emissions in the atmosphere. Now, this emission trading system is introduced by the government of Gujarat as a pilot project in the city of Surat. And how this emission trading system works? It works on the idea of cap and trade, whereby the government declares a cap on the emissions to be given out by an industry, and one industry might reduce their emissions, whereas another industry will exceed, and any industry which has saved their emissions can convert their saved emissions into shares, while the industry which exceeded the target have to buy from the company A. And this trading mechanism is called as emissions trading, which I've said earlier is already established under Kyoto Protocol. Now, this cap and trade mechanism is a market-based system to regulate the environmental pollutions. And this scheme was designed, the Indian first emission trading system for the government of Gujarat is designed by the Gujarat Pollution Control Board in association with University of Chicago, the Economic Growth Center at Yale University, and also other collaborators from Abdul Latif Jamil Poverty Action Lab. And this is the first of a kind scheme in India. The emissions trading system is first of the kind system in India. While emissions trading have been commonly known for carbon dioxide, in the United States, it is available for sulfur dioxide and nitrous oxide emissions also. But in the world, this is the first such system for particulate matter alone. The sixth topic is about the Asola Wildlife Sanctuary, which are located in the border between Delhi and Haryana, was declared as an eco-sensitive zone. And this declaration of Asola Wildlife Sanctuary as an eco-sensitive zone was made by Ministry of Environment and Forest and Climate Change. I want to emphasize here, it was not made by the state government or the Union Territory government. It is made by the national government. And the declaration is for about 1 kilometer around the Asola Bhatti Wildlife Sanctuary in Gurugram and Faridabad as eco-sensitive zone. We will discuss about the eco-sensitive zone in the next slide. And a few points about the Asola Wildlife Sanctuary. And this sanctuary is a part of Aravalli Range that are located in the border region between Delhi and Haryana. This is the wildlife sanctuary. And it is fundamentally a semi-arid forest and is considered to be an important part of leopard wildlife corridor, and it is also the designated place where the urban monkeys that are captured in Delhi and Chandigarh are often been relocated to the sanctuary of Asola Wildlife Sanctuary. In addition to this, this sanctuary also acts as water recharge zone for Delhi, Faridabad and Gurugram as well. Let us see few background information about the eco-sensitive zones. The eco-sensitive zones was adopted by the National Board for Wildlife in the year 2002 during a conference on wildlife conservation strategy. And under this conference, it was accepted that eco-sensitive zones forms a 10 kilometer eco-fragile zone around protected areas. If this is a protected area, it can be a national park, wildlife sanctuary or reserve. And a 10 kilometer surrounding this is called as eco-protected, eco-sensitive zones. It is usually a 10 kilometer zone. And what is the objective of the eco-sensitive zone? Eco-sensitive zone is intended as a shock absorber and a transition zone from the higher to the lesser protected areas. And this declaration of eco-sensitive zones usually is under the legal protection from the Environmental Protection Act 1986, and it is usually notified by the Union government. And even though it has mentioned that eco-sensitive zones covers 10 kilometers around the protected areas, very often it can be less than 10 kilometers or more than 10 kilometers or so. And this difference in the zonation of the eco-sensitive zone is meant to be site-specific. So it is a site that determines the coverage of the eco-sensitive zone, and also it is related to regulation rather than prohibition of specific activities. In the eco-sensitive zone, the idea is to regulate the activities but not to prohibit. But to add more point, once eco-sensitive zone is declared, there are three categories of activities that might be regulated. The first one is called as prohibited activities, which includes commercial mining, sawmills, industries that causes pollution. And regulated activities, it comes examples such as felling of trees, establishment of hotels and resorts, commercial use of natural water, etc. And the third category is permitted activities, which are such as ongoing agricultural or horticultural practices, rainwater harvesting, organic farming, a few. So once eco-sensitive zone is declared, there are three categories of activities that are been under the purview of the government: prohibited activities, regulated activities and the permitted activities. The next topic is about phosphine to be used as a fumigant. In large spaces like storehouses or buildings where the crops are usually stored, the agricultural produce are stored, the pests are a big menace. But to deal with these pests, conventional methods may not work, and that is where fumigants comes into the picture. So fumigants are gaseous pesticides. Because they are gaseous pesticides, they can easily diffuse into the whole structure. Fumigants are gaseous pesticides that are used to control pests in agricultural fields, structures like buildings and apartments, storage houses and other sites. The commonly used fumigants are sulfuryl fluoride, formaldehyde, methyl bromide, chloropicrin and iodoform. Why it was in the news? The scientists from National Center for Integrated Pest Management and Indian Council of Agricultural Research were looking for alternatives other than methyl bromide. In India, methyl bromide is one of the widely used fumigant, and the scientists were looking for an alternative. And the alternative that was found was considered to be phosphine. So the scientists of National Center for Integrated Pest Management and Indian Council of Agricultural Research have found that phosphine can be used as a replacement for methyl bromide. And phosphine is normally produced from aluminium phosphate as a basic substrate. Now, what are the reasons that makes it justified to look for a replacement for the methyl bromide? Methyl bromide is commonly used for killing insect pests and also as a quarantine fumigant at ports, because at the ports where the agricultural produce from other countries are landing, it is always first to be quarantined and later to be taken into the country. So methyl bromide is used as a quarantine fumigant at the ports. Now, looking for a need, why there need to be a replacement for the methyl bromide? The first and the foremost reason is methyl bromide is an ozone depleting substance. It is said to be 60 times more stronger ozone depleting potential than chlorofluorocarbon. Chlorofluorocarbon has already been phased out of the world, but methyl bromide has to be phased out by 2015 by the developing countries. India, being one of the developing countries identified under the Montreal Protocol, it should phase out the methyl bromide by 2015. So to honor the commitment of India to the Montreal Protocol, that there is a need to look for the methyl bromide. That is the second reason why there is a need for a methyl bromide replacement that we can find in phosphine. And the third reason is the use of methyl bromide is still prevalent in India. The use of methyl bromide is still permitted and very often enforced during the export of food products. And it is to be noted here that the use of methyl bromide has been taken out by the other countries, whereas only very few countries such as India and other Southeast Asian nations are still resorting to the use of methyl bromide. Let us compare the methyl bromide and its replacement phosphine. According to Directorate of Plant Protection, Quarantine and Storage, which works under the Ministry of Agriculture, this Directorate of Plant Protection, Quarantine and Storage is a nodal agency that regulates the entry and the exit of plant and the plant-based products. And according to this directorate, the domestic use of methyl bromide in warehouses is banned, whereas it is mandated to use methyl bromide for the exports of agricultural produce from India. And whenever it is banned, we need to look for a replacement. And phosphine can be a better replacement for the methyl bromide. And when we compare phosphine and the methyl bromide on two aspects, one, toxicity, and two, activity. Let us compare first in terms of toxicity. Methyl bromide is not very suitable for repeated use because it gets settled and leaves residues on the grains. And also very often the grains which were stored in the warehouses need to be fumigated every 3 months. So there will be a large accumulation of this methyl bromide on these grains, which is why it making it unsuitable. When we compare the same with respect to phosphine, there will be no residual buildup of phosphine and is more suitable over methyl bromide in the aspect of toxicity. Second, in terms of activity, methyl bromide in fact is a fast acting fumigant, and it also can be quick acting and kills important pests like grain borers, beetles and weevils within 24 hours, whereas phosphine usually takes more than 5 days. So in terms of toxicity, phosphine is preferred, while in terms of activity, methyl bromide is preferred. But when we compare in terms of health impacts, methyl bromide is a carcinogenic agent and must all be avoided in any cases. That is the reason why phosphine is considered to be the best choice in the future to be used as a fumigant in India. The next topic, number 8, is about what are called as polyfluoroalkyl substances. These are harmful substances that are finding its way into the human community through food. A new study found out that a lot of perfluoroalkyl substances enters the human food chain through the food products. Now let us see a few points about that. Perf and polyfluoroalkyl substances are man-made chemicals. They don't occur in nature by themselves. They are man-made chemicals, and some examples are perfluorooctanic acid PFOA, perfluorooctane sulfonate PFOAs, Genex, and other such examples. Where they are usually found? To give a best example for that, in the chocolate wrapper, we can see the shiny coat on the inner wrapper cover, which makes the chocolate not to stick with the wrapper. Now, that non-sticking wrapper is usually made up of polyfluoroalkyl substances. So, they are usually found in resistant fabrics that are used for cleaning, paints, and also mainly in food packaging. It is through this food packaging that I said earlier, it enters the human food chain. As they are man-made substances, they are known to be persistent in the environment. They are persistent organic pollutant. And persistent organic pollutant also have an impact on the human systems. They are widely found in the consumer products such as cookwares, pizza boxes, and stain repellents. And as based on a 2019 Food and Drug Administration of US report, India have not accepted the an amendment of the Stockholm Convention that was listed out in 2009. The amendment included the inclusion of polyfluoroalkyl substances into the banned list of substances. But India have not accepted this amendment so far, and hence it is still widely being used in the food packaging substances in India. Now, what are the health impacts that it makes? There are a wide range of health impacts that it makes, and some are: 1. It causes increased cholesterol level among exposed populations. 2. It is also related to poor outcome of infant birth weights. 3. It is also known to interfere with the immune system. 4. It is carcinogenic. And 5. It also disrupts hormonal functions, particularly thyroid hormone. So when we are looking for polyfluoroalkyl substances and its damage that it causes, we need to look for alternatives. So fluorine-free alternatives that can be potentially used are such as silicone, ceramic, or enamel-based coatings. Topic number 9. Let us discuss about mung bean, the heat stress that the mung bean may face and its consequences, and what is the recent discovery about this. Heat stress. It is not faced only by the animals. Even the plants also faces the consequences of the heat stress. So for a plant, heat stress can occur from high daytime temperatures and also high nighttime temperatures also, as well as high soil temperatures. And the heat stress is due to the collective result of intensity of the heat, the duration of exposure, and the rate of increase in temperature. In the life stages of the plant, heat stress experienced during reproductive stages of a plant can adversely impact development and function, such as reproductive compartments, flowers, pods, which thereby severely affecting the yield of the crop. Now coming to the mung bean. Mung bean is primarily a crop of rainy season in India. However, with the development of early maturing varieties, it has proved to be an ideal crop for spring as well as summer seasons. Mung bean is basically a leguminous crop, which means it also has the capacity to fix atmospheric nitrogen through symbiotic nitrogen fixation. Mung bean is a nitrogen fixing crop. It is also can be used as a green manure crop. Because it is fixing nitrogen, it can also be used as a green manure crop. Now coming to the next, is it a Kharif crop or Rabi crop? Now there is no absolute determination on that. In North India, it is commonly cultivated as a Kharif and a Kharif crop in summer seasons. In South India, it is cultivated as a Rabi crop in the winter season. So the Rabi, the mung bean, is a short duration crop that lasts only for about 70 days, and it also particularly faces about 45 degrees during its flowering and the podding stage in North India. And this causes serious damage to flowers and pods because of the heat stress that is caused. And unfortunately, there are no heat tolerant varieties of mung bean presently being used in India as of now. Now, why it was in the news? There was an independent research about alleviating the heat stress from the mung beans through the application of gamma aminobutyric acid, or GABA. GABA aminobutyric acid is an amino acid, but this amino acid does not found in the proteins. So it is called as a non-protein amino acid. It is also a neurotransmitter that is functioning in the central nervous system. So it is a non-protein amino acid that plays a wide role, such as regulation of carbon metabolism, maintaining pH, osmotic pressure inside the cells, and also protection from various stresses, particularly heat stress. There is another function also which I mentioned earlier. It also functions as neurotransmitter in the central nervous system. Now, coming to this discovery, because it is now found out that gamma aminobutyric acid protects plants from heat stress and also other stresses such as osmotic stress, it was found out that the application of GABA can reverse the heat stress related damages, and this can help better to be applied in roots as well as in the leaves. Also, naturally, it was found out that in Arabidopsis plant, gamma aminobutyric acid is known to accumulate in the leaves when they are exposed to high heat environmental conditions. So the ultimate point of this discovery is that gamma aminobutyric acid can help mung bean plant to recover from the heat stress after the exposure. Topic number 10 is about a species called Tamil yeoman. And this species in 2019 was declared as the state butterfly of Tamil Nadu. Butterflies is considered as an indicator of the quality of an ecosystem because they are sensitive to environmental conditions such as temperature, sunlight, humidity, and rainfall patterns. Butterfly species, which is Tamil yeoman, biologically called as Cirrocrova thais, has been declared as the state butterfly of Tamil Nadu. This butterfly is also commonly called as canopy butterfly, and also locally in Tamil Nadu it is called as Tamil Maravan, which stands for Tamil warrior. With this declaration, Tamil Nadu become the fifth state to declare a butterfly, state butterfly. So which in the other four includes Maharashtra, and its state butterfly is Blue Mormon, M-O-R-M-O-N. The second state is Uttarakhand, which declares common peacock as its state butterfly. Don't be confused by the word peacock. The common peacock is a butterfly species. The third is Karnataka, which declared southern bird wing as its state butterfly. And fourth, Kerala has declared Malabar banded peacock, which is also butterfly species, as its state butterfly. And Tamil Nadu become the fifth state to declare so. And to say a few points about this Tamil Nadu yeoman species, it is considered to be endemic to Western Ghats. The species is endemic to Western Ghats. It is most commonly found in moist deciduous evergreen forest and also found along the water bodies. Its characteristic feature is that it is a fast flight butterfly which goes in a straight line with a very few beats, and it is also known for a long glide. In terms of the appearance, it is uniformly orange in color with a dark brown outer ring. And In addition to Tamil yeoman, the other two species, which is Karnataka's southern bird wing and the Malabar common peacock of Kerala, these three species are considered to be endemic to the Western Ghats. This butterfly species also known to move in large groups in large numbers, but found only in the mountainous regions. Topic number 11 is about the intricate relationship between Wolbachia bacteria and mosquito and how we can make use of this particular unique relationship. As a common saying goes, enemy of my enemy is my friend. This particular proverb is true for Wolbachia and mosquito as well. Wolbachia is a gram-positive bacteria that are commonly found in about 60% of the insect species such as mosquitoes, fruit flies, moths, dragonflies, butterflies, etc. So it is one of the most commonly found bacteria in the insect species. But not all the mosquitoes can carry the Wolbachia bacteria. When it carries, when Aedes aegypti mosquitoes carries Wolbachia bacteria naturally, the transmission of dengue, Zika, chikungunya and yellow fever viruses is significantly reduced. I would like to emphasize here, the presence of Wolbachia bacteria naturally in the Aedes aegypti mosquitoes can reduce the viral load of dengue, Zika, chikungunya and yellow fever in these mosquitoes. It will not play any role on the bacterial diseases and other parasite diseases such as malaria. So Wolbachia plays its role only in reducing the transmission of viral diseases of dengue, Zika, chikungunya and yellow fever, for which Aedes aegypti is the vector. In terms of the infection, Wolbachia lives inside the intestines of these insect cells and are passed from one generation to the next generation through the insect's eggs. If an Aedes aegypti mosquito that normally don't carry Wolbachia, but we need to introduce this bacteria in conditions conducive for the natural transmission of the Wolbachia bacteria. So in terms of the damage to the ecosystem, Wolbachia bacteria does not cause any infections to the humans, and thus there is no risk at all to the humans and to the environment as well. As I mentioned earlier, the focus insect here is Aedes aegypti, because Aedes aegypti is the main transmitter of dengue, Zika, chikungunya and yellow fever viruses. Topic number 12, world's first food safety day. In 2018, United Nations General Assembly passed a resolution to commemorate June 7 as a World Food Safety Day. In 2018 it was passed. So the next year, 2019, the June 7 was celebrated as the first World Food Safety Day, and the theme for the 2019 is Food Safety, Everyone's Business. Food and Agriculture Organization FAO and World Health Organization WHO have been the designated agencies to lead efforts in promoting food safety around the world. And this designation was made in the 2018 resolution itself. And the objective of the day, World Food Safety Day, is to create awareness about the importance of maintaining safe food standards and also to reduce the burden of deaths due to foodborne diseases. Topic number 13, it is about a unique plan called as Plan B in Indian Railways that has won the Best Innovation Award for the year 2019. Man-animal conflict is a globally recognized problem which comes in conflict with the human aspirations and the wildlife interests. Very often, the infrastructure projects such as roadways, railways that traverses into the protected areas comes into conflict with the wildlife that are living there. Very often the Indian elephants crosses the railway tracks and get hit and dies. To avert this problem, there were various attempts taken. One such unique and a very successful attempt is called as Plan B. So Plan B is a strategy adopted by a Northeast Frontier Railway. The objective of the Plan B is to keep wild elephants away from train tracks. And for this, they received the Best Innovation Award in Indian Railways in 2019. And the award is given by the Indian Railways. It includes a citation and a cash reward of Rs. 3 lakhs. And what the Plan B is about? The necessity for the Plan B was done when a report found out that 67 elephants were died by mowed by the trains between the year 2013 and 2019. So they were trying to find a solution for this. And it was found out that elephants are very much scared of swarming bees. So inspired by this, Plan B was constituted. So Plan B is simply a sound device that is amplified at a large scale. It is an amplifying system that imitates the buzz of a swarm of honeybees. And this sound will be audible in about 700 to about 800 meters, which will keep the wild elephants away from the railway tracks. And first such Plan B project was installed in the level crossing in the west of Guwahati of Assam. According to NFR officials, National Frontier Railway officials, the Plan B and other conservative measures have considerably saved the lives of the elephants. The numbers are not very important, but here I have been mentioned about 1014 elephants being saved from 2014 to 2019. Topic number 14, it is about the creation of a special force called as Rhino Protection Force. Now the Special Rhino Protection Force was created to help and aid conservation efforts of one horned rhinoceros in the Kaziranga National Park. This force, Special Protection Force, is raised as a collaborative initiative of central and the Assam government to control the rhino poaching in the Tiger Reserve. To note a point here, Kaziranga National Park is a Tiger Reserve as well. So to prevent the rhino poaching in a tiger reserve, a special force was created. This force constitutes 82 personnel, among whom 8 are women. But how this force is created? From where the personnel are drawn? Fundamentally, the Special Rhino Protection Force is a tiger protection force. The personnel are drawn from the tiger protection force. But it is called as a Special Rhino Protection Force because the threat of poaching is more for one horned rhinoceros than the tiger. So it is called as a Special Rhino Protection Force, even though the personnel are drawn from the Tiger Protection Force. As of now in India, there is only one existing pan-India level protection Tiger Protection Force. There is no existing Elephant Protection Force as of now. But this Special Rhino Protection Force is created only for the state of Assam.